happened to Rose Murphy?
Jingle bells, jingle bells.
Well, that's the wrong song, isn't it? Completely off my nut today. A very happy good morning. Jackie Chapman, our fine engineer, is with us again.
A waterfall, a waterfall.
And my name is Bob Crane.
Bob Crane.
That's right, we're here till 5 of 10.
Not so waterfall.
Get him out of the cereal. Rod Serling from the Twilight Zone is our in-person guest this morning. We'll get to Rod in a moment. Just a little drumming here with Ramsey Lewis and his trio. And here comes Santa Claus.
Differences in the taste. Manischewitz.
What a wine.
Manischewitz.
Are you the man from Manischewitz?
Yes. Have you got the blackberries for my wine?
Uh-huh.
The European blackberries?
Yep.
The luscious European blackberries?
Right.
The big luscious European blackberries?
Well, they're blackberries.
My good fellow, Manischewitz blackberry wine is 100% pure. The luscious flavor is natural. That's why we can say the difference is in the taste. So I repeat, have you got the big, luscious European blackberries?
Oh, big, they're not.
Next.
Are you the man from Manischewitz?
Yes. Have you got the blackberries?
Uh-huh.
The European blackberries?
Yes, he's got
the luscious European blackberries.
Manischewitz tastes like grapes right off the vine. Imported sun-drenched berries make the berry wines divine. That's why this famous label is your natural flavor sign. Manischewitz, man, oh, Manischewitz. What a wine.
Oh, there. Yeah.
Specially sweetened, a proud product of Manischewitz Wine Company, New York.
18 and a half minutes after 9 on the KNX clock's the time. That was Ramsey Lewis just a moment ago. And here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, knock down Santa Claus Lane. In a pretty hip version of it. Carol Steller, our Jim Dandy secretary there, will you clear the way for Mr. Serling, who's going to sit down? He's our in-person guest this morning.
Just kick them bottles under the sofa. We had a little party going last night.
Just kick them under the sofa. That's it. Thank you, Oz. 19 minutes after 9 on the KNX clock. It's going to be a fairly nice day today, incidentally. Mostly sunny, with gusty winds at times. High temperature around 57. There is a chance of showers or snow flurries in the vicinity of the mountains today. And if you're looking to go skiing, call Atlantic 79711. Rod Serling is a name that's been familiar with the television, or rather associated with the television industry. Since what year was it that you broke into television in a big way, Rod?
49.
Was it not that long
1949,
ago?
I did my first TV.
And what was the show?
It was a show called Stars Over Hollywood, done out here as a half hour. And I think I got all of $100 for the first script, Bob.
You wrote the script. For those of you who may not be familiar with television, Rod Serling is one of the leading writers. Actually, more than a writer, you've won awards for your What is a better word than writer? You're not really.
Is no better word than writer, Bob.
Really, I'm constantly. For instance, I refer to Tiny Little as a piano player, and he says, "Please, you know, I'm an artist or something."
No, writer is a nice.
Writer is a good.
Yeah, that's a fair sobriquet for any.
So you made $100 on your first writing effort.
They got what they paid for, Bob. It's as simple as that.
And then how did things advance from there, Rod?
I just kept on writing. And
it was stepping on people?
No stepping on people. At least not hard, Bob. I never left the Twilight Zone. I've been here 5 minutes. I think I'm back.
Is this like the Twilight Zone?
A little bit, a little wilder maybe, but very, very similar.
Talking about writing efforts, now back in 1949, you made $100 for your first TV writing effort. What does a good scripter, for instance, and without giving away any secrets, what does somebody get for a half-hour TV show today? Right?
The average half-hour show commercial network runs about $2,000 plus residuals.
And how long would it take a writer to turn out something like that?
Well, that varies, Bob. The average guy who knocks out of a Private Eye or a Western can do it in as little a time as perhaps a day and a half. The very serious Playhouse 90 writers say will work upwards to 6 and 7 months doing a show.
And what will he get as money to keep him going during that 6 or 7 months?
Very little. That's one of the problems, of course, with writing for television, particularly when you write for serious adult shows like Playhouse 90.
You really have to be loaded with loot then to get into it, to begin with.
That's one of the requirements, yeah. Not really, though. I know a few, you know, independently wealthy writers, but there's a great kick and a great challenge to doing a show like Playhouse 90 or Studio One or any of those.
But imagine a guy devoting 5 or 6 months, say, to a Playhouse 90 and getting his, how much money would he get for that?
Well, Playhouse 90 used to pay on the average of about $10,000 a script.
Oh, well, then that's...
And one can live on $10,000, you know, Bob. It doesn't heat a pool, but it gives you something to eat.
Turn out a couple of those a season, and you got a good thing going. I've read so much about the dearth of good dramatic television writing nowadays. Is there a...
No, there's no dearth in writing. There's a dearth in programs that buy serious, mature television scripts. You know, most of the good live shows have left the air. Studio One, Kraft, Playhouse 90, they're all gone. And what's left, of course, is a residue of half-hour stuff, which dabbles in film only. And though there are plenty of good writers around, there are very little places where they can sell their material.
Well, then, is the reason there is a lack of good dramatic effort in television, and especially in the live field, is the reason being that there is so much coming from Hollywood? Is Hollywood at fault for this?
No, not at fault. There are economics operative here. It's very difficult to try to produce and make up an expensive show which dies after its first time out. And the beauty of film, of course, economically, is that there it lies in the can. It can be repeated several times. There are residual rights and residual payments, you know, practically ad infinitum.
I've seen so many live dramatic efforts, though, Rod, that just left me absolutely cold. For instance, somebody did, and I think it was Playhouse 90, or one of the dramatic shows, did For Whom the Bell Tolls, and in a live version, and it suffered so much in comparison to what the...
That's been one of the major problems, Bob, with very ambitious guys, and I'm not knocking, I'm making a passing comment, hardly a judgment, that they try to do those things which the motion pictures have done so well. I remember a show, A Tale of Two Cities, that was done quite handsomely as a motion picture with Ronald Coleman. You know, with the scope and the physical depth that only Hollywood can lend it.
Yeah.
And then it was done on television, and it looked as if it were done in a clothes closet in Grand Central Station, you know, with six extras who you recognize because they kept passing the camera 9 times in a row, same guys. And that's always been my feeling, that if you're going to go big, probe deep, do it vertically, not horizontally, because a horizontal freedom can be accomplished very beautifully in motion pictures. Television, of course, has yet another dimension, and that's probing, that's depth. So I wish they'd leave those things alone, like For Whom the Bell Is Tolled, which was a massive effort, and I thought had some interesting moments in it.
But it was bad in one spot there. It showed them on the bridge where the attack was occurring, and the bridge especially lacked perspective.
Well, they bought that bridge, I think, from Gimbel's basement. It was part of a Lionel Train set, I think. Wow, that was the major problem
it
there.
It looked more like something from Abbey Rents, really. You see the guy throwing, you know, the scene there where in Whom the Bell Tolls, and I forget who the actor was who did it in the movie, but he was always saying, "I'm going to get myself a tank," you know, and he pulls the thing out and throws this thing. And it was almost like somebody was holding back his arm, like, oh, Charlie, you're going to throw it right through the set. So it's like he lobbed it over, and it went about 5 feet and blew up.
That was in the movie or the television show?
That's the television show. In the movie, I'm going to get myself a tank, and he threw this thing like...
In the movie, it was Akim Timurov. I don't know who it was in the thing, but he kept saying, I don't provoke. That's the thing I remember, the lovely line, and I don't provoke.
Rod Serling is our in-person guest this morning, and we've got so many things we want to ask Rod about his own particular show, Twilight Zone, for instance. We'll get to that in just a minute. Before we do that, though, a word about dives.
I'm sitting in one of the hottest full-size cars built, the 1962 Dodge Dart 440. It's not like any Dodge you've ever seen or driven. It's a vital automobile. Everything about it makes you feel good. Take this fold-down center armrest. Gives you all the comfort of a bucket seat. This is a new size Dodge, a man-sized Dodge. It hasn't got a lot of senseless overhang. The important bigness is inside, where you can use it. It's a comfortable, high-performance automobile. It parks easy, steers easy. The buying's easy, too. The sticker price of a 62 Dodge is lower than a comparable model Ford or Chevrolet. See you around in a 62 Dodge.
That's right. See your Dodge dealer. There he goes, right out of the studio. Is this Twilight Zone all over again, right?
Yeah.
I'm telling you. You see your Dodge dealer here in Southern California for the 1962 Dodge today.
Be brave. Buy one.
You don't have to be brave to buy one. Now, come on. It's 27 minutes after 9 on the KNX clock. 27 after 9. 60 degrees is the temperature. It was only supposed to get to 57 today. Weatherman says mostly, so I don't know, the weatherman is off again. With a few scattered showers or snow flurries predicted for the mountains, gusty winds here in town, and considerable cloudiness is what they were saying. And incidentally, if you're going to the mountains, the high at Lake Arrowhead today is going to be 36 degrees. And call Atlantic 79711 before you leave to go up there, and they'll tell you whether the mountain roads are clear or whether it's snowing or what. Rod Serling, our in-person guest this morning. Rod, of course, is the producer of Twilight Zone.
No, right? I'm the so-called executive producer.
Well, who was the producer?
That's a titular title given like a wreath to somebody who owns part of the show. The workaday producer is an incredible guy named Buck Houghton.
Oh,
who produces the show.
Yeah, but every time I read something connected with Twilight Zone, it's Rod Serling that they're talking about.
Yeah, well,
we'd rather not get into that.
Yeah, let's not.
Buck hasn't been talking to you for quite a while.
No, that's true, and...
Well, it's a sore point. I'm sorry for bringing it up. We always manage to get one or two questions in there that make our guests uneasy. Let me ask you another question. If you had any, and this is a question that's been bandied around quite a bit lately, you talk about lack of sources for material. You go pretty far out with Twilight Zone. Have you had much trouble this season with rejected programs where they said you couldn't put it on for various reasons?
No, we've never had that problem, Bob, though that is, I gather, a problem extant with many shows.
Yeah.
Like, wasn't it Bus Stop that did a show the other night Sunday?
They had Fabian as a sex maniac in the thing, and they said you couldn't put it on.
But they put it on.
It was a bibliographical thing. What's the word I'm looking for?
No, it's me, Bob.
Well, forget it then. They put it on. Anyway, no, would that be wrong, bibliographical? It's terrible anyway. Over KNX-CBS Radio in Los Angeles, 1070 on your AM dial, 93.1 on your FM dial. Rod Serling is our hot seat guest today, and we're asking him some questions here. Anyway, the bus stop thing, true, it did go on. And a couple of the reviewers said all the fuss and clamor and whatnot, it really wasn't worth all the fuss and clamor.
Found it offensive.
You did find it offensive?
I frankly did, yeah. I thought this was sex for its own sake, predatory violence that was pure exhibitionism. I thought it was a lousy show. And if Fabian is listening, it's just been a rough night, it's very cold, and I'm sorry. But I didn't care for it at all.
Jack O'Brien in the Journal American said, well, one thing, his acting's as good as his singing.
Well,
and I read that.
Damned by the faintest of praise, I guess.
I didn't know what he meant by that either.
Well, it's easy to not, Bob. I suppose there are many people who found it, you know, a very stirring, exciting, emotional excursion. I, for one, didn't. But that's what makes ball games, I suppose.
But you have never run into a sponsor or network resistance on any of
only,
your shows?
Well, not on the Twilight Zone. Only once we had a show where it took place on a British steamer.
Yeah.
And the captain had a line where he said, bring me up some tea to the bridge, which, you know, is a traditional thing with the British. They drink tea all the time.
Yeah.
Well, we had a sponsor who made instant coffee, and they wouldn't permit the mention of tea. They didn't make tea. So they made the captain say, bring him up some coffee. Well, of course, this was quite erroneous and was incorrect. So we changed it to sandwiches.
Oh,
I don't know what he drank. Seawater, I think.
Really?
Yeah, that's the only major problem. It's the only problem we've ever had on the show.
For goodness sake.
Except that they kept saying that I should look taller, and that's impossible. They used to say, I did one acting stint one time in my life. I've only acted once, Bob, on a Desi Lou show, and they kept saying, bring out the man maker. And this was like a cigar box about 4 inches high, and they made me stand on this thing because my head hit Keenan Wynn's belt buckle.
Yeah.
And I looked like kind of Mickey Rooney with dark hair. And I refused to stand on this so-called man-maker because Alan Ladd's done very well at 5'6" all his life. Why should I, you know...
Actually, what is your height, Bob?
5'5" and a half.
Oh, that's nice.
He said proudly with a glint in his eye.
Well, look at Jack. And
look at Jack.
He carries it well? How much? Jack weighs 200 pounds. He's 5...
I don't believe it.
Will you have a cup of coffee?
Will it be?
It's 29 before 9.
A good cup of coffee seems to be everything good that has ever happened to you. It is finding a silver dollar or seeing the sun come out after a spell of rain. It is the incense of domestic happiness. For a good cup of coffee turneth away wrath and bringeth in tenderness. To those who treasure this rich boon, this cup of kindness, may we say, we do too. At Hills Brothers, coffee is all we make. Won't you join us in a good cup of coffee?
Let's get together whenever, wherever the living is good. Cause that's when Hills Brothers coffee's at home.
A delicious cup of coffee every time with Hills Brothers coffee, of course. Rod Serling is our in-person guest this morning. And we're asking Rod some pertinent questions about things we've had in our mind ever since Rod broke into the television business in 1949. What were you doing prior to then, Rod?
Radio, Bob.
What shows were you writing for then?
Oh, Grand Central Station and again, Stars Over Hollywood, Curtain Time. You know, those were those marvelous golden days when radio came on with dramatic shows at night.
What was the show that Barbara Luddy and...
That was Mr. First Nighter or something, wasn't it?
Oh, I'd love that. Barbara Luddy...
Here's your seat, Mr. First Nighter. Yeah.
And Olin Soule, and you'd sit at home, and you'd picture yourself in this lobby, and the guy would say, sitting down from the trees.
Right. That's right. Well, first the cab pulled up, didn't it?
That's
the door
right.
Opened.
That's right, the cab...
Here's your seat, Mr. First
Jack
Nighter.
Has the original cab in there. Jack, would you bring in the cab, please? This is the First Nighter. This is, for those of you not familiar with it. That's the fellow walking down the aisle, Jack. That's Olin Soule walking down the aisle. He used to lead people to their seats. The cab, open the cab door there. You open it up. He'd say, your cab, sir? That's not the cab, Jack. And then the people would walk into the theater, and it was an old theater, actually, and they'd sit down in
there. It was an older cab, Bob, wasn't it?
Well, Jack's an old engineer. He only remembers those days. And then the curtain would descend. They'd always say, and now the curtain rises, and then they'd do the whole thing. And at the end of the first act, so they could get in their three commercials or whatever it was, they'd say, and as the curtain falls...
Oy vey.
Samuel Brunston presents Charlton Heston, Sophia Loren in El Cid.
And then the story would
you
begin.
You bought your honor with my sorrow.
There was no other way for me. The man you chose to love could do only what I did.
Did you think the woman you chose to love could do less than you?
But my love won't die.
Kill it.
You kill it! Tell me you don't love me.
Charlton Heston, winner of the Academy Award for his performance in Ben-Hur. Sophia Loren, acclaimed Best Actress at the Cannes Film Festival. Together, they bring new chemistry to a love that has lived through the ages. See the motion picture El Cid, directed by Anthony Mann.
Now, for the first time, someone dares tell this different story. You'll be shocked.
You'll be thrilled.
You'll laugh.
You'll cry.
You'll wish you stayed home.
Filmed in Super Technorama Technicolor. Produced in association with Deer Film Productions. El Cid, the greatest romance and adventure in 1,000 years.
That's right. Be sure to see El Cid, which begins an engagement at the Carthay Circle Theater December the 18th, today being the 11th, just about a week away. Reserve seats now for the roadshow engagement of El Cid, starring Charlton Heston. 25 minutes before 10 on the KNX clock, leaving Rod Serling alone to have his Hills Brothers coffee for a moment here, we turn to the music of Johnny Klein in the Carolyn Bells, and for Christmas, Silver Bells. Silver Bells is done by Johnny Klein and the Carolyn Bells there, and A Christmas Sound Spectacular, it's called, the most beautiful rendition of that particular Christmas song. If you suddenly find yourself around the holidays here, imbibing perhaps a little bit too much, Jackie Chapman, our own engineer, had a little party over the weekend. He was telling me about this morning. And to show you how much this guy had, we went out to breakfast this morning at 7 o'clock. I wore an overcoat, mind you. He went in his undershirt. He had so much alcohol in him, really. And he kept on saying, gee, it's warm, isn't it? It's just terrible, terrible thing, Jack. You've got to cut out that drinking there. He's got a problem. Every time he passes a... What is the line there? Every time he passes... No, every time he walks down the street, he turns into a saloon. No, that's not the line. Forget it. The cold and flu season is here. So remember this. The one thing doctors consistently recommend to reduce the fever and relieve the pains of colds and flu is aspirin. It's what 9 out of 10 doctors themselves take. And all you got to do is ask them. And for a fee, they'll tell you. Bayer aspirin has instant flaking action, brings the fastest, gentlest relief you can get from the fever and painful discomforts of colds and flu. Have you ever had Bayer aspirin as one of your sponsors, Ron?
No, we haven't.
How did you miss them? That's a good one. You've, of course, seen their ad on television where they drop the water.
No, they drop the pill in the water, don't they?
No, they've got a new one now.
I've seen that.
They've got two things. They've got a Bayer aspirin and they've got some unidentified thing. And they drop water on it, and they say instant flaking action. Notice how the Bayer aspirin...
We're sponsored by the unidentified thing, Bob.
Butter?
No, I'm kidding.
Is butter one of your sponsors? Do we have them?
That's the high-priced spread.
Oh, that's what it is, and they won't say what it is. But they never tell you what this other thing is on the Bayer aspirin thing, the thing that doesn't have instant flaking action. It's a hockey puck. And that's the whole thing there. Now remember, aspirin is what doctors consistently recommend to reduce the fever and relieve the pains. Aspirin is what 9 out of 10 doctors themselves take. The best aspirin you can buy is Bayer aspirin, so you be sure to get it today. Now, 20 and a half minutes before 10 on the KNX clock's the time, 20 and a half before 10. We promised 13 different people this morning we would ask you this question about a Twilight Zone that was on about a month or so ago. It was concerning fallout shelters. Now, on this, you must have had quite a bit of reaction.
We had 1,300 letters and cards inside of 2 days. I think we hit some kind of a nerve. It was a show called The Shelter, about a doctor who had the only guy in the neighborhood who had the presence of mind and the foresight to build a shelter.
Yeah.
And when there's a yellow alert sounding, why, he runs into the shelter with his wife and child, and all the neighbors are left high and dry, and they turn into animals. And... I used the show, I wrote it because I felt, number one, it had great immediacy. We've been talking at home, my wife and me, about the possibility of building a shelter.
Yeah.
And we were struck with the moral and ethical problem of what would happen if, you know, there were an alert sounding.
Yeah.
We got into our shelter happily because we'd built one, and neighbors with children came to the door and said, please let us in. Well, that was the problem. I can't answer it. I don't know what is the ethical rightness and justice of this. I haven't figured it out yet.
It is a very controversial thing because I saw a panel discussion just about a week or so ago on this, and they had some learned men on the panel, one gentleman with civil defense, another who was in the clergy, Catholic priest, a Jesuit priest, and they all had different opinions. One gentleman said in particular, until the government starts building them themselves, public shelters, I can't see where there's this immediacy is here. You know, why should I go out and spend $2,000 or $3,000 to build one if the government isn't bothering. This was his feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So I can imagine when I saw your show that night, which was this problem in its most dramatic terms. Here was a family in their shelter, as you said, and here were the neighbors. What do? You carry a gun with you, shoot them off, or what do? And your show finally ended. It was a false alarm.
It was a yellow alert, which turned out to be nothing. But I think the essence of our philosophical comment at the end was that for the human race, to survive, it has to remain civilized.
Now, was that the ending that you wanted to take, or did you want to leave it a little bit stronger than
that? No, because I'm not one of those, quote, knowledgeable men, Bob. No. I don't know. I was up in the air about it, morally and ethically. I didn't know how to end that thing. I didn't know what position, philosophically, I could take.
Are you yourself building a shelter?
No, we're not now.
Were you?
For a while, we thought very seriously of it. Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
And now we've decided that, no, we're not going to build it.
Why?
Well, for very realistic, you know, stringently realistic reasons, that it's my feeling now that if we survive, what do we survive for? What kind of a world do we go into? You know, if it's rubble and poison water and unedible food and my kids have to live like wild beasts, I'm not particularly sure I want to survive in that kind of a world. This is this is the happy show, Bob, and yak it up again, Bob.
No, but the reason I'm asking, this week happens to be the Bill of Rights week, doesn't it?
It does indeed, yeah.
And this is what we're all fighting for, supposedly, and which is a serious subject in itself. You can't joke around about the Bill of Rights. And no, I just wanted to get your own opinion. What do you think of the Bill of Rights?
Well, I'm delighted. Wonderful having this chat, Bob. And no, I'm glad you asked me that.
Yeah.
No, this week, starting as of yesterday, does commemorate the Bill of Rights, which are the first 10 amendments to the United States Constitution.
Yeah.
And it's something that, you know, it becomes kind of unseasonable and a little bit overly sentimental at times to recollect the nature of our country. And I don't think it's unhealthy to reflect that this is a pretty incredible nation. And that unlike most nations on the face of this earth, we are protected by the Bill of Rights.
You know, the funny thing is, when you start getting sentimental about this country, so many times somebody will say, oh boy, is he getting corny now. This is a common thing, you know.
Yeah, as I say, you know, suddenly it becomes a little bit esoteric and a little idiotic to recollect what it means. And I don't think it's either corny or ham-boned to do some recollecting.
You got a point there, Rod, and I didn't mean to be so glum or morbid.
That's
about
all right, Bob.
Really, because it is a problem. For instance, I brought up a subject one day on the show here, Rod, about fallout shelters. Now, taking it for instance, you build a fallout shelter for you and your wife. It only holds two.
We got two children. That makes it a little bit.
All right, let's suppose that. Here is Rod Serling with his wife and two children. You have built a fallout shelter that only holds four. Comes an attack. There's a knock on the door. It's Bridget Bardot. Now, the question is, how long will it take you to get your wife and kids out of the shelter?
Now, science discovers that washing dishes with a new miracle product can actually benefit fingernails.
A mess.
Here are the facts. Independent laboratory tests prove...
Jack.
Frolic with Mirasol promotes healthy nail growth.
Oh, wait,
gives
Jack.
Nails more gloss.
Why did he leave?
Makes nails 48% more flexible. Give your nails a beauty treatment. Get dishes beautifully clean with Frolic, only dishwashing liquid with Mirasol.
I thought it was a...
Don't delay. Get Frolic now.
Thought it was an intelligent question. He just runs out like wild banshee. That's the way he wants to work this thing. Over KNX-CBS Radio in Los Angeles, 1070 on your AM dial, 93.1 on your FM dial. This is Bob Crane with the records. Actually, Rod Serling is still with us here. But it's I'm being facetious now, bringing up such a... There's no... It's she's in France, you know. The problem would never occur. Marilyn Monroe here. Marilyn Monroe's in the country. All right, Jack, there's another question for you. Marilyn Monroe shows up, and who would you call? You know, Joe DiMaggio? He's with her. I see. All right. 14 minutes before 10 on the KNX clock's the time. That answers the problem right there, if he's with her. 60 degrees, the KNX temperature right now is only supposed to be up to 57 today, and it just goes to show you, you can't believe anybody nowadays. Showers or snow flurries are predicted for the mountains today, mostly sunny today and tomorrow, and gusty winds at times with a temperature around 57 degrees. And as I said, it's already above that. In talking about mail to your show, now you received quite a bit of mail on this fallout shelter program that you did. What, in your mind, what type of person writes to a show? Now, you must get mail on most of your shows, because they're a little bit way out. In fact, it's the Twilight Zone, the name of it. That's the whole idea of the show.
Well, like many shows, our mail falls into two very specific categories, Bob.
Yeah.
They're very bright, astute, intelligent people who have a point of view and who let us know it.
Yeah.
And then there's the wild fringe group, the lunatic group. And these people, I think, write therapeutically. I think they are sick, and they write compulsively, and they write strange things. Now,
like what?
For example, the reaction to the Shelters show.
Yeah.
We got considerable mail from very odd people who said it was communistic, that it was defeatist, that it presupposed that we're going to be bombed, and that in doing so we were making a great disservice to the cause of defense and national security. We get an awful lot of mail like that. But this harks back again to the Bill of Rights Week. Amendment 1 stating that there should be no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of people to assemble peaceably. And I'm delighted. Let them write anything they want. I don't think we're in trouble in this country if we let people say, talk, think, comment. This isn't our problem. It's when we start to abridge that.
But
we can start being afraid.
Do you notice when people write nasty letters to you? I've noticed this, and if you read the mail yourself, you'll notice this, that when they write things like, I hate you, will you get out of town, you boom, and you notice they press hard?
On the pencil.
On the pencil.
Always, yeah.
It's like this, and you get a splotch like that, like they've been crying while they're doing it. You know, terrible person, yeah. And I can picture, really, many times I'll read a letter like this, and I'll picture the person that wrote this letter as being in a cold water flat somewhere.
Well, usually they're very unhappy.
Unhappy. And they sit in this cold water flat, and they listen to radio, watch television, they write letters, and this is their whole being, writing that. I don't know who supports them. And they sit there and write these terrible things, like, Rod Serling, I watched you tonight, you're too short. And, you know, I hate short people. You know, they have nothing else to pick on, because that show that night happened to be a happy show. They'll write, for instance, we got a letter when I first came out here, and somebody says to me, why, when you have a guest, Bob, must you tell them your history? we'd like to hear about them. But really, this has...
Tell me about yourself, Bob.
That's enough talk about me. Let's talk about you, Rod Serling. What do you think of me? It's 11 minutes before 10. No, they'll write these. When we first came here, one person used to write, you idiotic imbecile. Get out of town, you bum, you terrible person. And they wrote all the time, and it was terrible. Idiotic imbecile. Every day, this letter and card, and they used to press down on the thing, and I'd picture the person as being in a cold water flat and, you know, half out of their mind. And one day, I decided to do something. My rating was low at the time, too. Have you ever had a low rating problem?
Often.
What you do is you have the people, instead of waiting to be called, have them call the rating service. It's the simplest thing.
Oh, I see.
And
very
I did that.
Interesting.
I did that one day, and I had the people call Pulse. And it was a great idea, and the boss came in that morning, and he says, what are you doing? What are you doing? And I said, I've got people calling Pulse. I'm going to get the rating up. He said, that's not the way the game works, you idiotic imbecile. And all of a sudden, I knew who was mailing the letters.
How much easier life is. You can bend it and twist it and shape it and smooth it and heat it and...
And mold that Reynolds Wrap to fit the tightest corners of your pans. It'll catch all the drippings. Keep those pans really clean.
Right.
But be sure to get the genuine Reynolds Wrap, the aluminum foil that's oven-tempered for flexible strength.
Yes. Reynolds Wrap. It's 9 minutes before 10 on the KNX clock. 9 minutes before 10. And we do want to thank our in-person guest for this morning, Rod Serling, for stopping by. Rod, I'm terribly sorry we're running out of time here in about a minute. We've got 13 other things we've got to do. This always happens, and especially when we have such an interesting guest as you. I hope I didn't bore you with my stories here.
Not at all. I've enjoyed it, Bob.
You think we might make a Twilight Zone out of this whole thing?
This is a Twilight Zone, Bob.
Rod Serling, our in-person guest for this morning. And best of luck with the show.
Thank you very much.
And if you get any more of that nasty mail, just let us know. I know who it is that's writing. It's the boss. Did you ever see our boss? He's got a cold water flat downtown. He's got a light like this. When one compact car gains 1 million happy owners in just 2 short years, that is news. And that's a Falcon record this year. The hard-to-beat Falcon is certainly not hard to get. Your nearby Ford dealers delivering the full line with no delays, 2-door and 4-door sedans, the luxurious Falcon Futura, an all-new Falcon Squire wagon, plus 7 other wagons for a total of 13 wonderful Falcons. The way the Falcons are coming in, he can afford to make you a better deal than ever before. In fact, your Ford dealer today is losing $1,000 on every sale. The only way he can stay in business is through volume. So don't decide on any compact before you've seen and test-driven the Falcon. Compare the low, low price, lowest for any 6-passenger car. See how much more is standard on a Falcon. The best compact deal in town. Choose your Falcon now at your nearby Ford dealers of Southern California. think the background music is a little bit louder. Of the band and the Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairy, a rather appropriate song for this Christmas season. And speaking of sugar plums, from the tropical island of Trinidad comes a flavor secret that puts extra goodness into everything you cook. Angostura, a century-old secret blend of delicate cinnamon, cloves, nutmeg, tropical fruits, and chicken fat and booze. A symphony of flavors in one bottle that adds a tropical jungle or tangle or tingle or forget it. Forget the whole thing. Who writes these commercials? He presses much too hard on the pencil. Add a tantalizing taste and a tempting fragrance to almost every dish. Stew, soup, cream dishes, Angostura bitters, available, by the way, at Giordano Markets in Santa Barbara in the section where you find table sauces and seasonings. It's a fact, you've probably had Angostura bitters on your shelf for years. Get a booklet now that tells how to use the stuff. The secret, it won't last forever that way. The secret of better taste, with more than 100 famous recipes, write to me, Bob Crane, KNX, and I'll send the Angostura booklet out immediately. Rod Serling, our in-person guest from Twilight Zone this morning. This is Bob Crane. Till tomorrow morning, the same time. Have a real nice Monday. Bye, huh?
This is KNX, AM and FM, CBS Radio, and...